disaster, as WHO has mentioned, it is an occurrence which disrupts the normal conditions of existence and causes a level of suffering which exceeds the capacity of adjustment of the affected community. Now, the expected percentage of critically injured who report to the hospital during a disaster, it varies depending upon the nature of the event. But it is estimated to be approximately 16% of the overall number of survivors. So the goal in mass casualty scenarios is actually to minimize the morbidity and mortality of these critically ill patients. Now, why is critical care medicine important during disaster preparedness? The responsibility of caring for the most serious but salvageable casualties in natural and man-made disasters, it ultimately involves the critical care physician. So the role of intensivist is important in leading this preparedness and in planning for the events of this nature. So what is actually disaster preparedness? Now the type of disaster, it actually predicts the number of critically ill patients who report to us to the hospital. These patients, critically ill patients during disaster may vary from 1 to 10 during multiple shootings to up to thousands and tens of thousands during natural disasters or pandemics and during nuclear explosions. So by preparedness, we mean developing the ability to expand the critical care capacity beyond the ICU to non-routine ICU care areas and to educate non-critical care staff on how to assist in providing care as well as to plan for additional supplies and medication requirements. So it is important that during a disaster, the critical illness is recognized early, it is treated, and the admission to ICU is expedited. Now, under normal circumstances, we know that the hospitals, they can increase their critical care capacity by 20 to 50%. But during emergency mass critical care, for this, the hospitals should be capable of increasing their capacity to as much as 100 to 200%. This is because there is a sudden surge in the number of patients who report to us to the hospital during a disaster. So during this surge, we actually need to increase the space, the stuff, which is the equipment and the staff. So how do we increase this space? One is we need to transfer out of ICU all the non-critically ill patients, cancel non-emergency surgeries which will require ICU post-operative care, and use predetermined non-critical care medical space that is adequately equipped to support this critical care. So you should look for alternate locations where these critically ill patients can be kept, because the thousands of patients who you receive in during a disaster, most of these critically ill cannot be managed in the ICUs itself. So you need to look for alternate locations which have a similar facility or similar environment and equipment characteristics like an ICU. So you can place your critically ill patients besides the ICU in post-anesthesia care units, in emergency departments, then in high dependency units. Then you also need to increase your equipment, assess the on-site equipment inventory, identify the crucial equipment which is needed, and if you anticipate a shortage of equipment, determine how this crucial medical equipment can be obtained. Then third and the most important is your staff, which is the most important ICU asset. And during a disaster, you may have to increase the nursing to patient ratio, may need to extend the scope of practice for nurses and technicians, and involve non-critical healthcare professionals who have to work together with the critical care staff. So the team members should consist of intensivists and non-intensivists, which include the anesthesiologists, physicians, pulmonologists, infectious disease specialists, cardiologists, so on and so forth. In addition, the nursing staff, which is the backbone of any critical care, this also needs to be increased. So those who are most experienced to take care of critically ill patients, they should be made in charge. And critical care nurses would care for the most challenging patients and be available to assist the non-critical care nurses as needed. Then the healthcare workers who do not have a nursing background, they also have to be enrolled to deal with such mass tragedies like disasters, and they assist in the general activities that fall under the purview of nursing responsibilities. In addition, we require respiratory therapists who plan for medical gas and ventilatory support equipment, including in areas which are not traditionally the intensive care units. So what are the various disaster scenarios which may require critical care? These would include your natural mass casualties like earthquakes and hurricanes, in which you may have patients who, from a few hundreds to thousands, and these come mainly with blunt injuries, penetrating injuries, crush injuries, renal failure, and respiratory problems. Then there may be people who come to you because of a man-made casualty like a factory explosion, pandemics like we are currently undergoing one, then the chemical agents, weapons. So these are many disaster scenarios due to which patients may report to you during a disaster. Now, when such a high number of patients come to you and most of whom are critically ill, it is not possible to take each and every patient into the ICU and look after them. So what is very important is to triage these patients. So triaging the critically ill patients in the mass casualty situation is actually a challenge, because in this case, the medical critical care is provided not necessarily to the sickest patient, but the one who has the best opportunity for a long-term survival. So in these cases, we divide the patients into red, yellow, and green. So the red ones are those who require urgent life-saving interventions. The yellow ones are in whom immediate life-saving interventions are not required. And the green ones are with minimal or no medical care is needed. So once we have decided on the level of urgency which prevails in a particular patient, we have to prioritize whom to take into the ICU. So the highest priority is given to those critically ill patients who require invasive mechanical ventilatory support, who require a hemodynamic support and monitoring, like those who are on inotropes, who require a continuous renal replacement therapy because they are in renal failure, then therapies who requiring aggressive monitoring, and patients with significant metabolic derangements, patients who are hemodynamically unstable, have a threatened airway, are maybe cyanotic, have seizures, have a neurological deterioration. So all these are the patients who have the highest priority and they should be taken into the ICU first. Low priority patients are those who actually do not require a ventilatory support. They may be having a chronic organ dysfunction or maybe having an advanced malignancy, in whom the chances of survival as it is are less than those in whom patients who just need observation, and patients who may not benefit from admission to ICU. So once the patients are admitted into the ICU, how do we manage these patients? The first and foremost is the initial evaluation and resuscitation of the patients. When the patients with following a disaster, they report to us, most of these patients have a number of injuries. They are patients of polytrauma. They may have penetrating injuries, head injuries. So a number of injuries are there. They may be bleeding all over. So first and foremost is you recognize the life-threatening conditions and treat them in a prioritized sequence. So you go by A, B, C, D, and E. That is, take care of the airway, the breathing, circulation, disability, which is the neurological status, and then completely expose the patient and look for any injuries. So first and the foremost, whenever you're managing a disaster victim, is taking care of the airway. This is the first priority. You need to clear the airway of all the blood and the secretions, suction, administer oxygen, and open and secure the airway. By securing the airways, maybe you put in an endotracheal tube so that you know that now the airway is secure. And the patient, because most of these patients may be in respiratory distress. Then at all times, while you are assessing and managing the patient's airway, take care to prevent movement of the cervical spine. Because whenever such victims come to us, it is always assumed that they have some spine injury unless and until it is proven otherwise. So whenever these patients are to be shifted, they should be shifted on a spine board. Whenever you need to move these patients, take care to always immobilize the spine. Next is taking care of breathing and ventilation. Now, when you have made the airway patent, it always does not ensure that the patient is being ventilated properly. Because for adequate ventilation, the gas exchange should be adequate so that there is oxygenation and carbon dioxide elimination. So this ventilation actually requires adequate function of the lungs, the chest wall, and the diaphragm. So during disaster, or when the patients have so many injuries, there are certain conditions which can impair their breathing. which include some of these are actually very life threatening and should be immediately identified and managed. And these include tension pneumothorax, massive hemothorax, open pneumothorax, and tracheal and bronchial injuries. So these are the life threatening injuries which should be immediately managed because they greatly hamper ventilation. So if you're suspecting a pneumothorax or a hemothorax, immediate chest decompression should follow by putting in a chest tube. Then third and a very important measure is taking care of the circulation, because most of these patients have bled a lot. You have to identify the source of bleeding, which may be external, which you can see, or it may be internal. The patient may be bleeding internally. So it is important you identify this, and definitive bleeding control is essential. At the same time, you have to replace the lost intravascular volume. So always immediately establish large bore peripheral intravenous access and give fluids. And all of these solutions should be warmed either by storage in a warm environment or administered through a fluid warming device. Initially, always give 1 to 1.5 liters of fluid, and most preferable is your crystalloid, which is isotonic saline or Ringer lactate. Fluids, very important to remember, is they should be administered judiciously. Commonly, we see lots of fluids being given, which is not needed. If a patient does not respond to your initial 1.5 liters of fluid, then after this, please do not give more fluid, just give blood. So, because over-aggressive fluid administration in a bleeding patient can lead to dislodgement of clots and increase hemorrhage. Instead of helping you, it will cause more harm. So always give your fluids judiciously and start blood early. So what we do in disaster patients is a damage control resuscitation, in which fluids are administered initially up to 1.5 to 2 liters, after which start blood early. And balanced transfusion ratio for resuscitation of bleeding patient is you give 1:1:1. That is 1 unit of packed RBC, 1 unit of platelet, 1 unit of FFP. So that ratio is followed. And it is very important to avoid this lethal triad, which we see in these disaster victims. You have to at all times avoid acidosis, coagulopathy, and hypothermia. So this is known as a lethal triad, and all these three things, it is very essential to avoid them. Then the fourth is D, that is disability. The GCS should be quickly assessed and see the level of consciousness. And it is very important in patients with head injury to prevent the secondary brain injury by maintaining adequate oxygenation and perfusion. So the standard treatment for patients with an established traumatic brain injury includes neurosurgical evaluation, serial neurological examination with scanning, seizure prophylaxis, reversal of coagulopathy, intracranial pressure monitoring, elective ventilation, and decongestant therapy. So in addition to measuring all the vitals like your pulse rate, blood pressure, you need to monitor the blood gases, that is the ABG levels, the body temperature, the urine output, which tell you about the adequacy of your resuscitation. Then chest x-rays can identify potentially life-threatening injuries which require treatment, like a pneumothorax. Pelvic films can show you pelvis fractures, because pelvis is one area which, if fractured, leads to a lot of blood loss. So it will tell you that the patients may need blood early. Then ultrasound comes in very handy during these times, because it is available at the bedside. An ultrasound examination will help you in quickly detecting the intra-abdominal blood or a pneumothorax or a hemothorax. Once the primary assessment, that is ABCDE, has been done and all the life-threatening injuries have been identified and managed, then we go on to the secondary assessment, which is the complete head-to-toe evaluation of the patient, taking a complete history and physical examination, reassessing all the vital signs, and then each region of the body is examined to look for other injuries which are less life-threatening, and then managing them. So during disaster, what are the special injury types which we may come across? One is blast injuries. Now the blast injuries, we all know that the blast wave is a supersonic overpressure shock wave, which is created by high order explosives. And it most of the time leads to multi-system life-threatening injuries caused by explosions. So these may be penetrating injuries, or they may be blunt injuries. Then there may be amputations, traumatic amputations, crush injuries, polytrauma, burns. So anything you think of the patient may have it because of these blast injuries. So all these have to be identified and managed. In addition, commonly patients come after chemical injuries. Now there are various chemical agents which can lead to a lot of harm to the patient. One of them is the nerve agents, which enter the body either through the skin or by inhalation. And these nerve agents, they disrupt the normal mechanisms by which the nerves communicate with the muscles, the glands, and other nerves. So to manage these, the patients, you need to identify which agent has harmed the patient. Then you need to ventilate with oxygen, give antidotes like atropine and PAM. Then there may be chemicals which interfere with the body's aerobic metabolism, like you have the hydrogen cyanide poisoning, which can lead to death within minutes. So this again is managed with ventilation and cyanide antidote. Then the pulmonary agents are the substances which cause pulmonary edema, such as chlorine gas. So if a patient has been, patients have been exposed to this, then the first and foremost is you need to terminate the exposure of the patients to these harmful gases and do critically manage these patients, and most importantly is provide them with oxygen and ventilation. Now, once we have looked at all the life-threatening injuries and managed them, then comes the continuous care in the ICU, which is basically providing basic physiological support to the patients while they are admitted in the ICU. So you require to give them adequate respiratory and ventilatory support, aggressive intervention to minimize the the secondary CNS injury. Then you need to resolve the acid base and electrolyte disorders, which are very common in these patients, and especially critically ill patients who are for a long time on a ventilator. Always maintain temperature within the normal range. Circulatory support needs to be provided either with fluids or with blood or with vasopressors. Correct the coagulopathy, provide antibiotic coverage, and most important is give good nutritional support. So as soon as possible, start with enteral nutrition. If there are some contraindications to enteral nutrition, start with parenteral nutrition, but it is very important to start with nutritional support early. The endpoints of our resuscitation are a stable hemodynamics, that is stable systolic pressure and heart rate, normal urine output. You should try to maintain a urine output of at least 1 ml per kg per hour or more than 0.5 ml per kg per hour at least. The normalization of the pH, the lactate, and the base deficit on ABG, when these are normalized, they all suggest that you have been successful in restoring the microcirculatory perfusion. And last but not the least, aggressive correction of any residual hypothermia and coagulopathy. So to conclude, the disasters and pandemics can result in a large number of critically ill patients who report to the hospital, which can overwhelm our current capacity to deliver critical care services, and they can present major challenges for management and resuscitation. The loss of these lives can be prevented or at least decreased with adequate preparation. ICU physicians must be prepared to receive patients in varying degrees of stability and be ready to take over and complete the resuscitative process. And how well the ICU physician is prepared to meet these challenges may critically affect the 24-hour survival after severe injury and also the development of potentially life-threatening complications. Thank you for your patient hearing.